Simon & Schuster Audio presents You Deserve the Truth. Change the stories that shaped your world and build a world-changing life. By Erica Williams Simon. Read by the author.
To the one who creates something out of nothing, I dedicate these words and everything that I am to you. Introduction. It was a cold Sunday morning in January, barely 30 degrees outside of our church. Snow was expected to hit the Washington, D.C. area soon, and although none was falling yet, the air outside was bitter. I was inside, standing in the front of the sanctuary, singing with the worship team like I did every Sunday. At 16 years old, I was the only teenager in the adult group. And no, it wasn't just because my father was the pastor. It was because this church, this ministry, this gift of music and worship and service was my life. From the time that my parents founded our church in our home when I was 9 months old, there was no place that felt more like home to me. On this day, thanks to my thick tights and enough rocking, clapping, and arm waving to rival a low-impact aerobics class, I'd worked up a light sweat. I loved singing in church. I'd have rather been right there, holding a microphone and singing songs to God with the people I loved than anywhere else in the world. I felt free. I felt alive. If you've never experienced worship in a black church, the only way I can possibly describe what it feels like is to call it a high. It takes you away from where you are and floats you somewhere in the clouds. Suddenly, you are before the throne of God, or in the Holy of Holies, or on holy ground, or whatever euphemism you choose to describe the overwhelming presence of the divine. You're miles away from your worldly troubles and concerns, pouring out everything that is inside of you, and somehow you feel as if the most intimate parts of yourself are being received as the most precious gift. I'm explaining all of this because on that day, the worship was pretty intense. The Spirit was having His way, which is what we say whenever we disregard the schedule and just go with the flow. And me? I was higher than usual. We all were, and so was Daddy. He'd walked up in front of the pulpit, singing along with us. He was wearing his forest green suit, standing 6'3", a small glittering gold cross around his neck. Without any effort, he and I suddenly found ourselves engaged in a musical call and response, back and forth. I wish I could remember what we were singing. All I know is that I was following his lead. He would sing something, and I would repeat, and that it sounded beautiful. As the shouts and tears quieted down and the music slowed, we went back to our seats and Daddy began to preach. He instructed us to open to Matthew chapter 9 and began to read the story of the new wine. In it, Jesus compares the new life that the gospel offers everyone to new wine. Daddy started to expound on the opportunity of an abundant new life being available to all who seek it. He was on fire that morning, walking back and forth, out from behind the pulpit, close to us in the congregation. As the church was erupting with amens and claps, he walked back behind the pulpit and paused like he did when he was about to say something good. New life, he said, as we hung on to his every word. New life. Before he could finish saying it a second time, he slumped. He leaned and grabbed the side of the pulpit to catch himself, but within seconds he fell to the ground. When I see this scene in my mind, this is when the ground shakes. I feel a physical tremble, like what you imagine would happen if the tallest, oldest, widest tree in the forest suddenly tipped over, the thud shaking the firmament for miles around. I'm certain that didn't happen, but I also wonder, how could anything in the world not have felt the impact of this, an actual earthquake? The moments after are a blur. Daddy on the ground, me running almost reflexively to the bathroom and slamming the door, trying to shut out the scary scene taking place around me. Yells to call 911. Me doubled over the sink, dry heaving, crying, "It's not okay, it's not okay. Please let it be okay." Then the stretcher rushing past me, my mother running beside it. Me in the front seat of my aunt's car as she drove me and my 9-year-old cherub-faced sister home to wait for news. Hours later, I remember opening the front door when I saw my mother and my father's best friend, his co-pastor, pull into the driveway. Her face shattered when she saw me, like a piece of glass hit with a bullet. I don't remember her saying the words, "Daddy died." but I do remember running. When we all went back to the hospital that evening to do whatever it is that people do when their people die, they told me that I could go into a room to be with him for a moment. I walked into where he was lying and held his hand, now cool, his gold wedding band cutting tightly into his finger. I placed my head on his chest and cried and cried. I cried to try to stop the ache inside of me, but it only got stronger. Silent tears fell, my throat and eyes burning. I said, "I love you, Daddy," over and over again, until the words lost meaning and I wasn't sure if I was actually still saying them or not. I knew that others were waiting to come into the room and have their moment, so I gathered myself, kissed him on the cheek, and for no particular reason, other than that the refrain was fresh in my head and I had no other words, I whispered, "New life." And that was that. Those were the last words my daddy said, and they were the last words I said to him. New life. Those words and that story would guide much of the next decade of my life, life AD, after daddy. My faith, my personality, even my politics were all grounded in a belief that new life was possible, that a better life should be accessible to anyone, that rebirth, recreation, a hard reset was our birthright. I felt a pull towards anything that could create a new reality for me, for the people I loved, and for people who needed and deserved more. I have tried with all of my might to bend those words to breaking, to mean more than the makeovers presented on reality television or the come-ups that we see on Instagram. I believe that it is something more. New life is why, after college, I chose a career that focused on helping people transform their communities and the country through activism and advocacy. I believe that everyone deserves to have a life free from the shackles of oppression and the systems of injustice and inequality that have held them captive. And I guess in some ways, that story and its meaning are what led to this book. The words were ringing in my ears as I walked away at 27 from an outwardly successful but secretly unhappy life on a professional hamster wheel. I didn't know what I was walking toward, nor was I fully clear on how I'd ended up in the life I was walking away from. But I was determined to discover what was holding me back from the life I craved. One free from anxiety and fear, from comparison and discontent, from instability and insecurity, from endless longing and lack, from confusion and disappointment. Now, having gone on that journey and essentially succeeded, I am committed to spreading this gospel, this good news. Life can be better than this. You do not have to be held captive to the current reality you're living, the one created by old stories, myths, and systems designed to suffocate you and make you conform. You do not have to live a life breathlessly chasing success, fighting the demons of self-doubt and engaged in constant warfare with your circumstances. No matter your financial background, age, gender, or race, no matter how much you've screwed up in the past or how confused you are or how much you feel like a fraud, it doesn't matter that you have absolutely no idea what in the world you're doing or how much Instagram and Facebook make you feel like you should. Even if the day's news makes you feel like the whole world is spiraling out of control, you can have a new life. Better than the one that all the statistics promised you. But change involves much more than a motivational mantra. Hear me out, let it sink in. You really can have peace, clarity of purpose, direction, and success in this hectic, broken world. And you can have a hand in fixing that hectic, broken world at the same time. You may be thinking, sure, si se puede. But how? Well, unbeknownst to me, when I first embarked on this journey, the answer to that very question was hidden in the second half of my father's sermon, the part he never got to preach. The scripture in Matthew 9:17 talks about how the only way to carry and hold on to that new wine, or new life, is to discard the old wineskins, the stretched leather bottles that held the old wine. If you try to pour the new wine in the old weathered skins, they will burst and break. We must pour it into something entirely new. In other words, we can't change our current lives and realities, our hopes, dreams, finances, or even our communities, without first changing the framework, the container that holds them. That container is made of stories. The stretched, weathered, and worn stories that we have been taught, that we have consumed, that have built our worlds, shaped everything around us, carried us from birth to now. Those stories shaped what we believed was possible. To continuously pour our vision for a new life and new world into a space already shaped and stretched by the beliefs and untrue stories of the broken world that fueled your discontent in the first place is a waste of time. And in order to build a new life and a new world, one that lasts beyond the short-term encouragement of an inspirational quote.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.